Professor Mangala Narlikar studied from University of Bombay and received degree of BA in Maths in 1962 and MA in Maths in 1964 with first rank and also won the Chancellor's Gold Medal. She initially worked at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, TIFR, in Mumbai and later worked as a lecturer in the University of Bombay and Pune. She has published a number of books and articles, both in English and Marathi language, on mathematics and related subjects. Professor Narlikar.
Let me first thank the organizers for inviting me here to talk on cultivation of scientific temper. Let me first confess that I am not a practicing scientist. I am only a teacher of mathematics, but I certainly like to develop scientific temper in me and also people whom I know. We are hearing about this need to develop scientific temper in our country for the last at least 20 years or more. Let us first see what we mean by scientific temper. It is assumed, of course, that all superstitions are exact opposites of scientific temper. And in India, we do find lots of superstitions. So there is certainly a need to develop scientific temper here. In childhood, one more thing I want to say, it's not in my lecture, but the first speaker put forward some points with which I agree. So I'm sure you're going to find some repetitions. Do excuse that, but I hope you will also find some new points to ponder over. What we lack here is teaching our children to ask questions. In childhood, we imbibe, we pick up lots of habits and beliefs from our family, parents, grandparents, and in general, all learned people around us. As we grow, as we go to school and try to think, a child is expected to think independently and ask questions about this. But that doesn't happen easily, because in our culture, being obedient to elders is considered more important than being independent and asking difficult questions. Science education as such teaches students physical science only in a very, very narrow field, and the students are not encouraged to apply this method of science in other walks of life. Let me quote a little experience that we had many years ago. We spent a whole year in UK at that time with our two small kids, aged 7 and 9, I think. And they went to the school in the neighborhood. We were in Cardiff. My husband had taken his sabbatical. And two nice experiences. One was that there was a good school in the locality, and the principal sent leaflets in all the houses. We are allowed to take even four-year-olds in the school, in the preschool class. So please do send your kids to our school. And to get our children admitted in a school in Mumbai, it was so difficult. And to have this experience instead, that the neighborhood good school is sending leaflets asking for students to come in. That was a very pleasant thing. So we sent our children there. They could just walk to the school in 5 minutes. It's very convenient. And both these girls started school. We were a little bit worried about how they are doing. Although they, at that time, they went to central school and they learned both the languages, English and Hindi. How will they cope with the difference in schooling there? So after about a month, we both went to the school and met the teacher. The principal met us and he said, "Both your children are fine. And yeah, their accent is a little different, but they can communicate. They're good with maths because they know their tables and they do the maths very good. But there is a problem." And then we were just worried, what is he going to tell now? "The problem is that your children do not ask any questions." 7 and 9 year old kids are supposed to ask questions as the teachers are teaching them in the class. Whereas in India, they are not supposed to ask questions. So that was a big thing that we realized that, yes, this is where our education is certainly lacking. Children have to think independently, try to ask the questions fearlessly. At the most, teacher will say that he or she cannot answer the question. That's it. But the children should be able to ask questions. That's what we learned there. Now, let me quote some experiences that I had regarding this professional scientist. I already told you, I'm not one of them. We were in Germany a few years ago, near Munich, and there were a few Indian young postdoctoral people there. Now, this man was working in chemistry. He had got his PhD in India, and he had got a postdoctoral scholarship, and he was working there. He told us, he comes from a smaller town in Maharashtra, but it could also be in Mumbai or Pune. I mean, it doesn't have to be a smaller town for this, for the story that I'm going to tell. And he told us that his mother ordered him to send his first salary when he got a job in a research institution, to send his first salary to Balaji Temple. Why? Because his mother had promised this to the deity, that she prayed to the deity that her son should get a good job, and when he gets the job, he will send his first salary to the temple. And the man or the boy, I mean, for us, it was a boy, but he had sent it, and he didn't seem to resent it, or he didn't seem to be unhappy about these incidents. A few years or a few months before, I read the news that, and the news was of criticizing our scientists from ISRO for going to the temple after a successful mission that they had operated. Now, do these, both these instances, are these, do they tell us about scientific temper? The third one, before any examination, I spent quite a few years in Mumbai of my life. Before every examination, there are long queues of students before Siddhi Vinayak Temple. Why? Of course you know why. They want to pray so that they tide well through the exam, and they also promise the TT that they will give something else, something better, if they tide very well and if they get good marks and things like that. Another experience that I want to quote, which has been happening to us quite often, that when one speaks about scientific temper and generally teaching of science and inculcating this temper and all, very often the question asked is, do you believe in God? Very often this is asked. And if the speaker says no, of course you know that then the speaker is an atheist. And very often the person who asks the question thinks that this person is out of another tribe. Can be even worse than a person from another religion. So they are not exactly worse, but certainly distant. So this makes me think. Does scientific temper teach people to go away from God or not to have a belief in God? Are all the people who have scientific temper supposed to be atheists? That they should not believe. Believing in superstitions is one thing. Believing in God is, mind you, another. You all know that. Just think of it. Over thousands of years, all over the world, in all cultures, the idea of God has developed. Different gods, different rules, different ways of worshiping. But so many people, so many cultures have felt that the idea of God is needed, that it is necessary. Does scientific temper insist that you should not believe in God? Does science know about God? No. I don't think these two questions should be related in this way. What should scientific temper do? Scientific temper teaches us to ask questions and try to find rational answers. Both are very important. Asking questions and trying to find rational answers. I find that more than 99% people, not 99%, sorry, I'm a mathematician, so I shouldn't make such a mistake. More than 99% of people that I know, they believe, and I respect these people. They believe in some God, and they have their own ways of worshiping. Why should I antagonize them? Why should I create a polarization between scientifically minded or people who like to develop scientific temper and people who want to believe in God? What I want to suggest is, I would like to have a different category of believers in God. I like to call them reasonable believers, believers in any religion, at least for me. I would call them Vivekanishtha Astik. But that word Vivekanishtha or reasonable is very important. I expect them to be open to reason, open to reasonable arguments and reasonable questions and finding logical answers. If a person finds peace of mind, encouragement to do good work, and generally sense of well-being by worshipping his or her God, why deny him that? Why should we take that solace away from so many common people? So I don't want to antagonize, I don't want to have a polarization between reasonable believers or Vivekanishtha Astik and people who want to develop scientific temper. That is the point I want to make. Then what does the scientific temper, what is it against? It is against holding up facts which are proved to be false by today's developed science. Like people have quoted the eclipses. Now school children are taught we can make models and teach them how every eclipse is just a play of shadows. So in this world, to ask the children to believe in Rahu and Ketu and to worship them, the children should straight away get rid of such things. But that we have to teach our children to be independent right from the beginning. Then, as the first speaker today pointed out, our children will be trained to become good scientists. Not scientists in a very narrow technical field which they are learning in school, but to do more original, fearless science. They should be able to ask questions and discard beliefs if they are proved to be false on the scientific reasoning matter. One more thing, we have to combine this humanity, and we have to, anybody who wants to inculcate scientific temper, not just these people, any people, they should also be against exploitation of torture of any people in the name of religion. This is not exactly connected with scientific temper, but I'm just trying to note the ways in which we can get our people to reform, to improve on the religion. Our friend from Dhaka said that this is an unfinished scientific renaissance of Bengal. This is an unfinished scientific renaissance of the whole country. That if we can do these two things, that do not uphold any fact which is proved false. See, this is quite different from what scientific temper really wants to inculcate. But this is the first step. See, I am teaching mathematics at all levels. Right now, I am connected with writing textbooks for small kids, 6, 7, 8 year olds. So I know how to teach in small steps. Let us first teach our people not to uphold statements which are proved to be wrong. Science also expects us not to believe anything in anything which is not proved. That is a much, much harder step. And as other people have noted, it is very difficult even for practicing scientists. Not to believe anything which is not proved is very hard. But we can certainly discard things which are proved to be false. Let us do this small step and also stop any religion from torturing or exploiting other people in the name of religion. These two steps will make a good progress. In short, scientific temper should not exclude reasonable believers from their group. Because, as I said, more than 99% people do believe in God. So let us have these reasonable believers. Let us help all these people to develop scientific temper slowly. Most superstitions are born out of religious beliefs and traditional practices which require some faith in some God. But if we teach them this sort of scientific temper, those superstitions at least should be discarded sooner. Even this doesn't happen very easily. That also requires a lot of effort. Injustice and exploitation of any people and belief in false statements, these are two small things that we want to start with. This is what I want to suggest to all our friends here. As I said, this doesn't happen easily. Even now, there are people who believe in Rahu and Ketu. But then there is also a society in Europe which they still believe in the flat earth. Admittedly, that is a very small society. So the society which believes in Rahu and Ketu can also be very small. We can neglect them. So these are the things that I want to suggest we start doing. And of course, the beginning has to be made with children and encourage them to ask questions in all different walks of life. We may or may not be able to answer the questions. It is a duty of scientists also to take science to people, to explain what they have done, what they have got, and not hype it. Science never claims to be perfect, and I know science doesn't claim to have answers to all questions either. The progress of science is very slow. So they have to take science to the people and they have to explain what exactly they have got. Don't exaggerate. And people will understand. Our common people have a much better common sense and they do understand. And they can discard wrong and harmful beliefs and practices. It has happened and it will happen again. Thank you.